Grace. Here's a little secret about grace. 10 little words that explain all you need to know. If God is for us, who can be against us? That's really all you need to know. That's Romans 8:31, by the way. That's really all you need to know. And while it sounds simple, there's a profound message contained within those 10 words. Let's take a look at 4 words in this verse that deserve your attention. And read it slowly, if you will, this phrase, God is for us. Please pause for a minute before you continue. Again, God is for us. God is for us. God is for you. Your parents may have forgotten you. Your teachers may have neglected you. Your siblings may be ashamed of you. But within reach of your prayers is the maker of the oceans, God. And God is for you. Not maybe for you. Not has been for you. Not was for you. Not would be for you. But God is. He is for you. Today, at this hour, at this minute, at this second, as you listen to this sentence, no need to wait in line or come back tomorrow. He is with you. He could not be closer than he is at this second. His loyalty won't increase if you are better or lessen if you are worse. He is for you. God is for you. If you look on the sidelines, that's God cheering for you. That's God cheering your run. Look past the finish line. That's God applauding your steps. Listen for him in the bleachers, shouting your name. Too tired to continue, he'll carry you. Too discouraged to fight, he's picking you up. God is for you. God is for you. Had he a calendar, your birthday would be circled. If he drove a car, your name would be on his license tag. If there's a tree in heaven, he's carved your name in the bark. We know he has a tattoo, and we know what it says. I have written your name on my hand, declares God in Isaiah 49:16. Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? God asked that in Isaiah 49:15. What a bizarre question. Can you mothers imagine feeding your infant and then later asking, what was that baby's name? No. I've seen you care for your young. You stroke the hair. You touch the face. You sing the name over and over and over. Can a mother forget? No way. But even if she could forget, I will not forget, God pledges in Isaiah 49:15. God is for you. Knowing that, who is against you? Can death harm you now? Can disease rob your life? Can your purpose be taken or your value diminished? No. Though hell may set itself against you, no one can defeat you. You are protected. God is for you. And that's what grace means. grace. Ponder the achievement of God. He doesn't condone our sin, nor does he compromise his standards. He doesn't ignore our rebellion, nor does he relax his demands. Rather than dismiss our sin, he assumes our sin and incredibly sentences himself. God's holiness is honored. Our sin is punished, and we are redeemed. God does what we cannot do so we can be what we dare not dream, perfect before God. God showed his love for us in this way. Christ died for us while we were still sinners, Romans 5:8. And you never have to wonder who your father is. You've been adopted by God and are therefore an heir of God through Christ. Galatians 4:7. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans 8:1. God justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Romans 3:26. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. Hebrews 8:12. For those in Christ, these promises are not only a source of joy, they are also the foundations of true courage. You are guaranteed that your sins will be filtered through, hidden in, and screened out by the sacrifice of Jesus. When God looks at you, he doesn't see you. He sees the one who surrounds you. That means that failure is not a concern for you. Your victory is secure. How could you not be courageous? Picture it this way. Imagine that you are an ice skater in competition. You are in first place with one more round to go. If you perform well, the trophy is yours. You are nervous, anxious, and frightened. Then, only minutes before your performance, your trainer rushes to you with the thrilling news. You've already won. The judges tabulated the scores, and the person in second place can't catch you. You are too far ahead. If you answer the big question of eternity, the little questions of life fall into perspective. Grace. Through Christ's sacrifice, our past is pardoned and our future secure. And since we have been made right with God by our faith, we have peace with God. Romans 5:1. Peace with God. What a happy consequence of faith. Not just peace between countries, not just peace between neighbors or peace at home. Salvation brings peace with God. Once a monk and his apprentice traveled from the abbey to a nearby village. The two parted at the city gates, agreeing to meet the next morning after completing their task. According to the plan, they met and began a long walk back to the abbey. The monk noticed that the younger man was unusually quiet. He asked him if anything was wrong. "What business is it of yours?" came the terse response. Now, the monk was sure that his brother was troubled, but he said nothing. The distance between the two began to increase. The apprentice walked slowly as if to separate himself from his teacher. When the abbey came in sight, the monk stopped at the gate and waited for the student. "Tell me, my son, what troubles your soul?" The boy started to react again, but when he saw the warmth in his master's eyes, his heart began to melt. "I have sinned greatly," he sobbed. "Last night I slept with a woman and abandoned my vows. I am not worthy to enter the abbey at your side." The teacher put his arm around the student and said, "We will enter the abbey together, and we will enter the cathedral together, and together we will confess your sin. No one but God will know which of the two of us fell." Doesn't that describe what God has done for us? When we kept our sin silent, we withdrew from him. We saw him as an enemy. We took steps to avoid his presence. But our confession of fault alters our perception. God is no longer a foe, but a friend. We are at peace with him. He did more than the monk did, much more. More than share in our sin, Jesus was crushed for the evil we did. The punishment which made us well was given to him, Isaiah 53:5. He accepted the shame, Hebrews 12:2. He leads us into the presence of God. Grace. Lord, if it's you, Peter says, tell me to come to you on the water. Matthew 14:2. Peter is not testing Jesus. He is not pleading with Jesus. Stepping onto a stormy sea is not a move of logic. It is a move of desperation. Peter grabs the edge of the boat, throws out a leg, follows with the other. Several steps are taken. It's as if an invisible ridge of rocks runs beneath his feet. At the end of the ridge is the glowing face of a never-say-die friend. We do the same, don't we? We come to Christ in an hour of deep need. We abandon the boat of good works. We realize, like Moses, that human strength won't save us. So we look to God in desperation. We realize, like Paul, that all the good works in the world are puny when laid before the perfect one. We realize, like Peter, that spanning the gap between us and Jesus is a feat too great for our feet. So we beg for help, hear his voice, and step out in fear, hoping that our little faith will be enough. Faith is not born at the negotiating table where we barter our gifts in exchange for God's goodness. Faith is not an award given to the most learned. It's not a prize given to the most disciplined. It's not a title bequeathed to the most religious. Faith is a desperate dive out of the sinking boat of human effort and a prayer that God will be there to pull us out of the water. The Apostle Paul wrote about this kind of faith, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is a gift. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." Ephesians 2:8-9. The supreme force in salvation is God's grace. Not our works, not our talents, not our feelings, not our strength. Grace is God's sudden calming presence during the stormy seas of our lives. We hear his voice. We take the step. Why? Because we are great sinners and we need a great Savior. We, like Peter, are aware of two facts. We are going down and God is standing up. So we scramble out. We leave behind the Titanic of self-righteousness and stand on the solid path of God's grace. And surprisingly, we are able to walk on water. Death is disarmed. Failures are forgivable. Life has real purpose. And God is not only within sight, he is within reach.
There's a winner!
grace. It was almost time for the Jewish Passover feast. Jesus knew that it was time for him to leave this world and go back to the Father. He had always loved those who were his own in the world, and he loved them all the way to the end. So during the meal, Jesus stood up, poured water into a bowl, and began to wash the followers' feet. John 13:1-5. Behold the gift Jesus gives his followers. He knows what these men are about to do. He knows they are about to perform the vilest act of their lives. By morning, they will bury their heads in shame and look down at their feet in disgust. And when they do, he wants them to remember how his knees knelt before them and he washed their feet. He wants them to realize those feet are still clean. Remarkable. He forgave their sin before they even committed it. He offered mercy before they even sought it. Aside from geography and chronology, our story is the same as the disciples. We weren't in Jerusalem and we weren't alive that night, but what Jesus did for them, he has done for us. He has cleansed us. He has cleansed our hearts from sin. Even more, he is still cleansing us. We are being cleansed from every sin by the blood of Jesus. 1 John 1:7. In other words, we are always being cleansed. The cleansing is not a promise for the future, but a reality in the present. Let a speck of dust fall on the soul of a saint, and it is washed away. Let a spot of filth land on the heart of God's child, and the filth is wiped away. Jesus still cleans his disciples' feet. Jesus still washes away stains. Jesus still purifies his people. Our Savior kneels down and gazes upon the darkest acts of our lives. But rather than recoil in horror, he reaches out in kindness and says, I can clean that if you want. And from the basin of his grace, he scoops a palm full of mercy and washes our sin. Grace. Family therapist Paul Faulkner tells of the man who set out to adopt a troubled teenage girl. Now, one would question his logic. She was destructive, she was disobedient, and she was dishonest. One day she came home from school and ransacked the house looking for money. By the time he arrived, she was gone and the house was in shambles. Upon hearing of her actions, a friend of Paul's said to him and urged him not to finalize the adoption. You haven't completed the paperwork yet. You haven't signed any documents. Just let her go. His response was simply, but I have already promised her that she would be my daughter. God, too, has made a covenant to adopt his people. His covenant is not invalidated by our rebellion. It's one thing to love us when we are strong, obedient, and willing. But when we ransack his house and steal what is his, this is the test of love. And God passes that test. For God shows his great love for us this way. In this way, Christ died for us while we were still sinners. Romans 5:8. The Father didn't look at the wrecked house and say, come back when you've learned respect. God didn't look at our frazzled lives and say, I'll die for you when you deserve it. No, despite our sin, in the face of our rebellion, he chose to adopt us. And for God, There's no going back. His grace is a come-as-you-are promise from the one-of-a-kind King. You've been found, called, and adopted, so trust your Father and claim His verse as your own. God showed His love for us in this way. Christ died for us while we were still sinners. And you never again have to wonder who your Father is. You've been adopted by God and are therefore an heir of God through Christ. Galatians 4:7. Thank you, Lord.
There's a winner in you.
Grace. During the early days of the Civil War, a Union soldier was arrested on charges of desertion. Unable to prove his innocence, he was condemned and sentenced to die a deserter's death. His appeal found its way to the desk of Abraham Lincoln. The president felt mercy for the soldier and signed a pardon. The soldier returned to service, fought the entirety of the war, and was killed in the last battle. Found within his breast pocket was the signed letter of the president. Close to the heart of the soldier were his leader's words of pardon. He found courage in grace. I wonder how many thousands more have found courage in the emblazoned cross of their heavenly King. If you need a bit of courage, let me show you a source of strength for your journey. Keep these words close to your heart and be confident that because of grace, you are beyond condemnation, Romans 8:1. You are delivered from the law, Romans 7:6. You are near God, Ephesians 2:13. You are delivered from the power of evil, Colossians 1:13. You are a member of His kingdom, Colossians 1:13. You are justified, Romans 5:1. You are perfect, Hebrews 10:14. You have been adopted, Romans 8:15. You have access to God at any moment, Ephesians 2:18. You are a part of His priesthood, 1 Peter 2:5. You will never be abandoned, Hebrews 13:5. You have an imperishable inheritance, 1 Peter 1:4. You are a partner with Christ in life, Colossians 3:4. You are a partner with Christ in privilege, Ephesians 2:6. You are a partner with Christ in suffering, 2 Timothy 2:12. And you are a partner with Christ in service, 1 Corinthians 1:9. And know that in the heart of God, you are a member of His body, 1 Corinthians 2:13. You are a branch in the vine, John 15:5. You are a stone in the building, Ephesians 2:19 through 22. You are a bride for the groom, Ephesians 2:25 through 27. You are a saint in the new generation, 1 Peter 2:9. You are a dwelling place of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians 6:19. You possess, get this, every spiritual blessing possible. In Christ, God has given us every spiritual blessing in the heavenly world, Ephesians 1:3. This is the gift offered to the lowest, lowliest sinner on earth. Listen, who could make such an offer but God? From Him we have all received one gift after another, John 1:16. Everything comes from Him. Everything comes through Him. Everything ends up in Him. Always glory. Always praise. Yes, yes, yes.